South African ex-president Zuma is being brought up on corruption charges, which is surprising because I thought he retired for fun. Turns out he retired so that he could spend more time with his family of lawyers. So what are these charges that he's facing? Now, the African National Congress, his party, has reminded us that people are innocent until proven guilty. Although generally, when you have to remind people of that, the light at the end of the tunnel might be an oncoming train. To hammer his innocence home though, here's a picture of him telling people he's innocent while doing his best xenomorph impression. Well, it seems like political crimes are like birthdays. Once the first few happen, you stop caring and keeping track. The case against him is currently for 16 counts relating to a $2.5 billion arms sale in the mid-1990s. Really? The guy has 783 charges against him, and your plan is to get him with the crimes he committed when I was still soiling my diapers? Come on, I know that since he's been president, the African National Congress has been going to exorcist levels of looking the other way on crimes, but there still has got to be some more recent crimes that doesn't incriminate any other party members. Anyways, let's talk crime.
This relates to multi-billion dollar arms deals made in the 1990s to procure fighter jets, submarines, helicopters, and other equipment for post-apartheid South Africa.
Fighter jets and tanks? All we get is Twitter bots and the occasional porn star. Now, these crimes are not new, and in fact, Zuma has had a will-they-won't-they relationship with the jail over these crimes for decades now. Although this time, prosecutors are saying,
after consideration of the matter, I am of the view that there are reasonable prospects of a successful prosecution of Mr. Zuma on the charges listed in the indictment.
Wow, sounds inspiring. Although no prosecutor is going to call a press conference to announce, let's temper your expectations. We're going to try our best, and as long as we have fun, that's what really matters. Well, the story starts in 1995, when South Africa decided to modernize every branch of its military with its strategic arms procurement package. Because, at that time, the fastest way to sink a South African ship was to put it in the water. Now, this was clearly a major undertaking, and since South Africa didn't make their own vehicles, they started off a bidding process between foreign companies. And there were so many bribes going around, I'm surprised South Africa didn't somehow make a profit.
Terry Crawford-Brown says companies like Britain's BAE Systems and Germany's ThyssenKrupp are among the firms that paid millions of dollars in bribes to South African politicians.
It was so bad that even the people whose bids lost were found to have paid bribes to some major people. Alright, so what is the problem? I mean, paying to get a contract clearly is ethically dubious, but the smoking gun was when BAE, a British defense company, remember that name, was taken out of the running in 1997 because their planes were too expensive. But then, suddenly, the then defense minister Joe Mondies decided he can't put a price on peace of mind, and unilaterally decided to remove the cost as a consideration for aircraft purchases. BAE then got the contract, and soon after those contracts were signed, Patricia de Lille, a member of the Democratic Alliance Party, a party in opposition to Zuma's African National Congress, produced a dossier of allegations.
Finally, after more than 13 years, Vuyo, I blew the whistle on the 9th of September 1999. We're now going to have this Commission of Inquiry.
This dossier led to the conviction of Tony Yengeni, an African National Congress member of parliament, for fraud, and Shabir Saik, remember that name as well, a man whose relationship with Zuma has been referred to legally as generally corrupt. Although I look forward to that becoming specifically corrupt, because he announced he was going to testify against ex-president Zuma. So what was Shabir Saik arrested for? Well, at the time he was Deputy President Zuma's financial aide, and he was arrested for soliciting a bribe on behalf of the president. So yeah, I'm sure he knows something. Now, there was a lot of covering up and refusing to let a government super investigating team snoop through the deal, which, come on, in the US all we get is special counsels led by people where it's their last job before they retire. The next real event that furthered this story happened in September of 2006, when the prosecutor dropped the charges against Zuma. Now, when I tried to find a video of that, I found that there are so many videos of different charges being dropped against Zuma at different times, it gets overwhelming, which is not a good sign. Now, most people would think, well, that's all I have to say about that. But in 2009, this was reported.
BAE Systems, the British defence giant, has made a fortune selling high-tech military hardware to governments across the world. But the firm has been dogged by long-running allegations of bribery and corruption. Now it hopes to draw a line under the claims by pleading guilty to two criminal charges and paying out £286 million in fines.
Turns out that when politics can't deal justice, sometimes good old-fashioned economic interests can. Defense contractors were fed up with losing out to BAE's overpriced technology just because they were the best at bribing people. So, investigations were opened in the US and Britain separately, and both found the company guilty of bribing people. Mostly in Saudi Arabia, but South Africa was a footnote, and that was enough to reopen investigations in South Africa. In response to this new information, on October 11th, now President Zuma had picked a three-man investigation force to look into the arms modernization case. And you're not gonna believe it, but in 2016...
According to the report, there was no wrongdoing. All the equipment is fully utilized, which is simply not true. For instance, at this moment, about 20 of the Gripen fighter planes are mothballed and are not utilized at all.
What? The Zuma-appointed counsel found him not guilty? Yes, it came back that there was no evidence of wrongdoing, which I'm sure was joy to the ears of the two people who had been arrested in charges of wrongdoing in 2001. That said, this report was pretty much entirely negated when, literally days later, a high court ordered that the dropping of charges against Zuma was irrational and reinstated them, which meant that the commission could have benefited society more for the last 5 years by just walking the streets and picking up pennies. Anyways, the investigation was back on, bringing us to where we are today. Which begs one major question. What did Zuma actually do? Now, a lot of reporting I've seen loves to remind you that...
He now faces a criminal court for 16 charges.
It seems like one thing everybody wants to hammer home is it's 16 charges, not 15, not 17. Well, the crime of his really started with a competing firm, Thompson CFC, a French company. Oh man, buying military supplies from the French is probably a hard sell on its own. Just look at all the wars we have won with our equipment. The French Revolution, and we're going to need an exceptionally large bribe, aren't we? Through his financial advisor, who we mentioned earlier was prosecuted, it was found that Zuma was trying to get a deal of 500,000 rand a year for influence and protection. There was a written forensic report about this in 2006, and I'll provide a link to read it, but it's 490 pages. So unless you're having a severe case of insomnia, I suggest you just let me summarize it to you. Basically, over 4 million rand was sent from the French arms company Thompson CFC to Zuma's financial aid and companies that his financial aid controlled, which were then being transferred to Zuma. Alright, so that's pretty much corruption bingo right there, with money laundering, intended to hide where the origin of money was, abuse of power, and accepting bribes. Not just that, but a submarine deal with similar corruption came up, but that was just kind of redundant, so it didn't get as much time in the papers. Now, the last major revelation that came out of this was it showed how in debt Zuma actually was. He was making it rain everywhere except Cape Town, and he couldn't live on the salary alone, so he was really dependent on these bribes. In fact, at one point, he had to get bailed out by Nelson Mandela. And if you're played by Morgan Freeman in a film, that should immediately exempt you from having to deal with that noise. So, that's everything you really need to know about this case. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. Remember to hit that subscribe button, and of course, click here for more episodes of Africa Wednesday. As always, thank you for watching.